the static correction. Last week, lectures were focusing on the determination of the travel time, or in other words, the velocities of the weather layer, in addition to the depths to the interface between the weather layer and the bedrock. Today, we are going to go back to Precambrian, as the geologists say, to our first lecture, if you remember. Okay, because once I'm receiving feedback, I figure out that some of you feels the course is so lengthy, and I want to make some abstraction from today and also for the coming lecture until the end of this semester. Are you reading me? Are you understand what I'm saying? I will try to give you some time every lecture to remember something we have taken throughout the course. And at the final stage, I'm going to make an extra session to answer your questions and to answer and to clarify some points that might be confusing to you. So I'm revising with you the 8 items that we should cover in the course. We have the mathematical basis for Fourier transform, and we have some good illustration and representation of this mathematical basis. Also, we have sampling considerations, and we speak about, or we discussed, seismic time series. And then we move to main processing sequence and velocity analysis and normal move out stacking migration sequence. Then, or before then, we have had deconvolution, convolution, filtering, and migration in space and time. And then we have acquisition of seismic data both on land and offshore. So we still have 2 points to be covered. And these 2 points to be covered is so important because it's nearly the cutting edge or the frontier of the technology now taking place, which is 3D seismic data processing and these are related to modeling, to tomography, radon transformation, tau B processing, Hilbert transform, and AVO, which is amplitude versus offset. So, starting from next week, inshallah, we're going to study these 2 articles. So what are we going to do this week? We have today's lecture and inshallah tomorrow's lecture. Today's lecture, we're going to continue our static correction. And tomorrow, if you remember, we in this point, the main processing sequence, We have 4 steps as main and about 10 steps as extended. In extended, there is sorting, there is recovery of amplitudes and static correction, one of these extended seismic data processing, and so on until we finish with tomography. So today we are going to finish the static correction, and tomorrow inshallah we are going to cover or give hints and glimpse of all of this, what is the nature and what's done, it's used for the nature or the basics of this point, and what is the aim of using such step. So if we are going to illustrate our situation so far, we can say that we almost finished 70% of the course, and we still have another 30% of the course. But the coming 30% is the most important, as I told you, because it's so related to current day technology, and also because it's really giving high reliable information if the situation and conditions for applying this, the 3D seismic data processing and the tomographic analysis, because we need abundant, redundant number of data to be used to carry out these steps. Okay? Excuse me? So, at any point, if you feel not understanding what I'm saying, you just tell me. Okay? You read me?
Yes.
Okay. So, do you remember our last lecture? Do you remember what it was about? Yes, it was seismic refraction. And we studied in seismic refraction, we studied last lecture, the modeling of the seismic refraction using the the time delay method. So, of course, it was about seismic refraction experiment. Okay? So, to refresh our memory and to abstract, so we're going to abstract backward from seismic refraction backward, so that at the last lecture we are going to review complex numbers and Fourier series and so on. Okay, so what is seismic refraction topics we studied? We covered nearly most of the seismic refraction topics: acquisition, TX graph analysis, modeling, and interpretation. It's not fully, this point is not fully, but maybe if you need extra session, we can discuss this point. For acquisition, we studied experiment planning and instrumentation. Now we want to make seismic refraction experiments. So what is the depth you are looking for? What is the target? So what, and then we choose the length of our array, the separation, between geophone. All this defines the length of the length of the array, describe or define the depth of penetration. So if I want to go down for say 30 meters, I should have at least the array, my array become about from 120 meter, about 4 to 5 times the depth of penetration. Okay, this is not solid. This is not solid principle because it change due to the change of the conditions. But we can generally start with this, and then we apply and try to have some information in the field during the experiment, and then return back and correct or modify the experiment to meet the required target. Okay? And also we have the instrument, and sorry, and geophone interval describe the horizontal resolution, the structure to be identified horizontally. So if I'm expecting to have a structure that's so limited in space, has few lengths, small lengths, so I should make the geophone intervals small. If I'm expecting the dimension of the feature I'm looking for to be large, so no need to make small geophone intervals. And then we go for an instrumentation. We speak about the geophones, the cable, the sources, and the recording unit. Of course, this is general, because nearly the same instrumentation used for seismic refinement, but with a small modification used for seismic refraction. And then we moved to travel time distance curve, and this is one of the pillar of all seismic methods, because at the early days, seismic methods was only directed or related to study the travel time distance relation, either reflection or refraction. In travel time distance relation, we started by data retrieval, which is taking the data from the recording instrument, and then we view the record, we view the data through seismic section plot. Then we pick first arrival. This is only for refraction. As you know, reflection is not first onset, and we are picking the reflector after series of operation. And then we plot the TX, the travel time distance curve, where the travel time is marked or is observed by the first peak, the first point we have. And then we identify the basic travel time distance curve features. We define the crossover distance, we define the intercept time, we define slopes. And also we check for the total arrival time, and we check for the slope of the second segment, which for our investigation can help to illustrate the dipping of interface. And then after identifying these parameters, we go Shan. Yes. Did you? No, no. Did you sleep well yesterday? I'm sorry, because research say that I cannot make you, if I am so good in lecturing, I cannot keep you focusing more than 30 minutes. But we have to stay together for 1 hour. So try to refresh ourselves every now and then. And then we go for modeling and interpretation. Actually, we were focusing on modeling, on determining velocities and depths, and also for a regular, for dipping layer to determine the angle of dip, and for the regular interface to determine the irregularity, how irregular is the refractor. Using, in our case, we use the time delay method. The last one that I guess and I believe should give, but not covered in this section, should be focused on in other, maybe other classes, or maybe we should arrange session for how to interpret the output, because this is the most important part, and this is the most important part that you are going to need either in your career, in working in the company, because you have to take into consideration that when you are sitting on the round table, people will not understand what do you really mean about intercept time, about migration, about velocities and depths. All what they need is, what is the geology, and how to combine this geologic model for the exploration they are carrying out. Meaning, where is the places that I advise the company to drill wells at? I'm not going to say drill here and here and here. It's not random method, but it's, I have some sort, you studied petroleum geology, I hope. We have types of traps. Traps where oil is, or gas is trapped or stored, prevented from migrating upward. So these are the accumulation of oil and gas, and this is the target of all exploration practice. So we go after making our analysis. We are not giving them velocities, but we are giving them geology. Finally, we should compile all our results to geology and recommending that the trap is here or might be here, and we need to make sure it's there by drilling well and applying 1, 2, 3, 4 from the logging techniques to define, for example, the porosity, permeability, fluid contents, and so on. Okay? So this point is so important to you for seismic, for gravity, for magnetism, for GPR, for all our analysis. We can speak to each other as geophysists in terms of physical parameters of the subsurface. But to speak with the other communities, we have to speak with geology terms. Okay? Like here in Malaysia. You can speak with each other in Bahasa Malaysia. Okay? But if you go outside or speak with somebody in Europe or United States or any other place, you should speak with language both of you understand. So we have to convert our geophysical parameters into geology which is the bottom line that all will understand. We have, say, anticline here. We have, say, drag fall here, and so on. This, we have structural trap. We have stratigraphic traps, and so on. Then one angry person, if you say, okay, you wasted our time. So what is the relation of this seismic refraction to our seismic data processing? He looks angry. Yes? So it's all about, I'm sorry, it's it should work directly, but it's yes, it's all about static correction. And this is Alaeddin lamp, in case you know what is Alaeddin lamp. You understand? Yes. So what does static correction do? Static correction corrects the seismic for the effect of altitude or elevation of the Earth's surface and remove the effect of weathering layer. We have two effects that we need to remove in the static correction, and that's why we are calling this static correction. We have the effect of the altitude. So our reference surface is not flat, as we said before. It was changing elevation. And also, we have weathered layer that happens to be extraordinarily of low velocity. Say, the velocity for weathered layer might be in, say, a few hundred meter per second, while the velocity in the bedrocks is thousands meter per second. So first, it will make delay to the section that will limit the resolution. So if I want to exaggerate the vertical axis, I will cut some of the later arrival, or I will compress the vertical axis, so resolution needed for interpretation is lost. This looks like the situation we have in our case. We have the GFON distributed at the Earth's surface, as you see. Okay? As you see from this figure, the Earth's surface is not flat. We have GFONs at higher elevation, and we have others at lower elevation. So if you are blotting the traces, you end up with mislocation in time by this change in elevation. And of course, the change will be related to velocity, because this part is crossed by seismic energy with the velocity of weathered layer. So it's time. And this time is related not only to elevation, but also to velocity. So to correct, I have to have an idea about the velocity of the weathered layer. And also we have this undulation, this irregularity in the interface between the weathering layer, which might be seen as the soil at the alluvium, like koalas and deltas and so. And here is the bedrock. So we need to define new data, and the datum, the new datum, is taken such that it's beneath the interface between the soil of the weathering layer and the bedrock. So we, for each trace and for each geophone or common midpoint, we are going to subtract this time. Now we're speaking about time. So we understand, or we have an idea about the velocity, and then for refraction, we have to subtract to estimate the time, and then subtract this time from the origin time of each trace. Okay? Shafiq. Okay? No. Excuse me?
The process is static.
The statics, yes.
The process is static,
right? Yes.
Can you repeat
it? Okay. Start by the effect of altitude. Okay? Now, the seismic section should have zero reference level, where time is taken from that level. Agree? Okay? So, this level or surface should be equal for all traces, because it's a zero time. In our case here, the geophones are not at the same spatial level. It's not at the same elevation. So the result will be this type of undulation or regularity will be represented in the reflectors down here. Again, suppose we have this as a surface and this one is a reflector. Okay? And we carried out our investigation regarding the effect here. So for each point, we estimate depths. And so on. Okay? Okay? So, if I want to plot the section, I usually put this is the level, this is the origin. And then I will put this H values, so the situation will be such that the reflector exhibiting irregularities related to the surface, not related to the geometry of the reflector itself. Okay? So, if I want to retain or to regain the actual geometry, I should correct for certain datum so that my observation, if any geometrical features here, it will be represented correctly. Because in the ferrous, without the static correction, we have geometry that's not related to the actual geometry of the refractor. Again, if you want me to repeat, I will repeat. Yes?
What about the resistance?
Why? What about the datum service? What? Why?
Yes, what is the datum surface? What is the function of
it? The datum surface, I'm choosing this datum surface. And then I estimate this time and subtract these times from the time of the trace. Okay? How to estimate these times? I estimate these times through the spatial distribution and from velocity. It's very simple. Velocity equals distance divided by time. So time equal distance divided by velocity. So if I defined spatially both these lenses and the velocity distribution, I can estimate the time. And then subtract this time from each trace so that I am making a new reference or a new datum. Okay, datum is a reference surface. And the reference surface should be constant, should be homogeneous, plane, like for example, when we measure the elevation, the altitude. What is the datum we are using for measuring altitudes? The sea level. Yes, it's the sea level. Okay, why we choose the sea level? It's a flat surface, and it's nearly constant all over the world. So it is a reference surface that we can use to obtain the difference in elevation. Of course, at some places there is some deviation, but in generally we observe that as the water, we have all water bodies, oceans and seas are connected, so the plane itself is constant. Okay, so we can use this plane to measure the increase in elevation or decrease in elevation. So this is a representation of what the situation for in the case of a topographic effect. Now we have the effect of topography. Here reflected, this is a refractor. This change in topography resulted in the problem of artificial or virtual geometry. For example, if you are not aware of this point, you may go directly and say, okay, I have anticline here and we have so and so and so, and you build all your report on something that's not true. It's fake. Okay? And this is what happened when we remove the effect of the both the wizard zone and the elevation. As you see, we have here dipping interface without the shape of without the sinusoidal shape that is reflected due to the surface. Now we have some examples. This one in Congo River. We have this one represent one datum. Okay, but in this notch related to the Congo River. So Congo in Africa, place in Africa. Okay. In Angola, you know Angola? It's in south, near South Africa. Okay. So as you see here, due to the river sediments, we have notch here, which is not true. This is related to the sediments, not to geometry. Okay, so one of the intention is to remove this notch due to the weathering layer here. It's not geometrical. It's not geometrical identity of the refractor, of the reflector, but it's due to the weathering layer above. Okay. Now this is taken from one of the software of Halliburton called Bromax, describing some terminology about data static correction. Here we have the Earth's surface. The red surface is called processing datum. These surfaces are used for normal move-out correction, CMB, gather, and normal move-out, and so. These depths represent the hole where the source is mounted and fired. So this is depths up hole for the number of shots used. Okay, and the inverted triangle on the surface is the receivers or the geophones we have. This surface, the red surface, is the final seismic reference datum we are looking for. So we have some terminology, some relation that are used for such case. We have any datum is a floating datum or NMO datum or processing datum, which is the red one. We have static correction, which is related to elevation. It's equal F datum. Okay, this one minus elevation plus depths, all divided by velocity. Okay, so this relation returns time. Okay, so we subtract from this datum. We subtract the elevation, okay, and then we add the depths. All these distances is divided by the velocity. assuming that we have constant velocity. If we have many velocities, like weathering layer velocities and so this must be taken into consideration. We have for the refraction static, we have the f datum minus elevation plus depth divided by datum velocity minus the uphole distance. Okay, this one. Thus, the complete static equals 2 times n datum minus f datum divided by datum velocity. Now for some examples. This example is taken from Stiblitz et al. 1990. As you see, the upper section represent uncorrected for static correction with 12-fold CdB gather stacked. I hope you see this one, this regular reflectors. This regular reflectors is not actually having the correct geometry of the reflector, but it reflects the both this one, this is the surface, and this is the interface between the soil or weathering and the bedrock. This one, see, is interpreted geologic cross section, and the final, this is the datum, the approximate datum correction using estimated information from the conventional data set study. Yes, we are at the end. We are going to, we are going to subtract at each geophone this time, at each trace this time, to obtain the correct figure. No, this is not. No, this is the static correction itself. This is time. This is the horizontal direction. It's not the geologic cross section. This one is a geologic cross section. Okay. And as you see, this one, this is a bedrock surface, and this is how the elevation looks like. Okay. Is there any problems that we have in seismic refraction? The answer is yes. And we speak about some or all, but it was hidden in our earlier discussion. We have two types of problems. The first one is a velocity inversion or low velocity layer. And the lecture before last, we have discussed that based on Snell law, we are looking for critical angle of refraction. But if the velocity of the deeper interface is lower, we never approach the angle of critical refraction. So all the energy will be diverging downward, and nothing from this specific interface will be come up to be analyzed at the surface. Okay? The other one is called the blind zone or the thin bed. As we also discussed before, we have Fresnel zone. Fresnel zone states that for any object or for any structure to be identified in seismic method, this the dimension of this layer or object should be at least 1/4 of the wavelength. So if the layer thickness is less than 1/4 of the wavelength, then it will not be detected in our seismic refraction method. Okay? Thank you.